And we couldn't be set free, and we had to come in there after a 21-day fast, and everybody together just start yelling in the name of Jesus, we bind you right now, we demand you to loose the people of God. And that's what I thought that meant. But the divine powers to demolish strongholds, the Greek word for stronghold is actually castle. You might say castle. Castle, it's a fortress. And the castle was normally the place, you know, where a king would live. Praise God. And so when I was thinking that we were bound by a stronghold, the stronghold was really a fortress. And in this case, it was the false teaching of the false teachers. That they were so arrogant and so proud that this was their defense mechanism and their teaching against God, Paul's doctrine. This was the stuff that they hid behind, and this was keeping the people of God from the knowledge of God. The rumors were keeping people back from the knowledge of God. Watch, give me verse 5. Demolish stronghold. We demolish arguments. He's telling you right there what the strongholds are. Their arguments. What were the arguments? No, Paul, you're wrong. There's no salvation through faith in Jesus Christ or this thing you're calling grace. Salvation only comes through circumcision. And people were confused. Well, you know, Paul just kind of started in his ministry. I'm going to go with this. A lady called me one day. I'll never forget. She called me. She had an urgent call. She had to get to me. And I thought something was happening to her. So I called her. I thought she needed prayer. And she called me to let me know, you know, Pastor, you know, I'm calling you because I talked to my pastor down the hill. And, you know, I started talking to him about, you know, this gate stuff. And he told me that I was wrong, that you were wrong. And so I just wanted you to know that he's been preaching for 20 years. So I'm going to believe him. So I can't come to your church no more. And I said, oh, okay. He says, well, you know, well, God bless you. You know, if he has any questions, you know, I wouldn't mind if he gives me a call. If he has any questions about the word, you know, just give him my number. And if he wants to ask me a question, he should be concerned if I'm preaching false doctrine, you know, so have him give me a call. You know, he never called me, you know, but that's the same thing that was happening with them, is that they were saying, no, Paul, we don't know. I mean, these guys have been preaching for a long time and you just started this whole new thing called grace and faith. And so now these were the arguments that were keeping the people of God from knowing God. Every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Man, these rumors were holding people back from getting to know him for who he really was. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. So the strongholds were not this invisible thing that was going on in the spiritual realm. It was the false teaching that were holding people back from the true word and the true message and the true understanding of God. So that when you keep reading the chapter, you get to the end of it and he says, but I came to you with the gospel, right? My weapon was the gospel message. This is what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the gospel message that God's son has come down from heaven. And I know this ain't fun because it takes out the fun from, you know, yelling at the devil, you know. But the truth of the matter is that the gospel is the effective word that we use to advance the kingdom. And Satan is doing everything he can to oppose it. But the more he's got you thinking there's something invisible going on in the spiritual realm, it'll take your focus away from actually being effective with the gospel message. Because the biggest threat to the enemy is the gospel message. Amen? Look, go over there to Ephesians. Watch, give me Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6.
Speak, Lord.
Ephesians chapter 6. Because an enemy is what? He's after what? Word. The word. He's after the word. He was after Paul's word. Paul was telling us how to be saved, how to receive, you know, Jesus Christ, how to become a Christian. And Satan was opposing him with all these other teachers. All right, now check this out. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. What does it say there? Now, what's the first word finally imply to you? Fine. The last thing on the list, all right? Finally, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. So we're about to go to this spiritual, you know, warfare stuff, right? But if he said finally, it means that something was preceding it. So let's see what precedes it. Go over there to chapter 5. Actually, chapter 4, 4 verse 17. Chapter 4, verse 17. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus Christ. You were taught in regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be in the likeness and to be like in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. And he goes on to tell them how to live holy. So before we get into all this spiritual warfare stuff, the first thing I want you to deal with, Paul was telling them, is you got to deal with yourself. You got to live holy, because you cannot be highly esteemed or greatly beloved if you aren't living holy. Amen. So the next thing he wanted them to deal with was what? And it says here in verse chapter 5. Verse 3. Chapter 5, verse 3. And it says, but among you there must not be any hints of sexual immorality, any kind of impurity or greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which is out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For if you can be sure of this, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such as an idolater, has an inheritance in the kingdom of God, of Christ, and of God. Praise God. So there he's telling them to live holy. It's that serious. You got to live holy or you will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, verse 21. Look at the next thing I want you to deal with. Verse 21. And he says, submit one to another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, verse 22. Submit yourselves to your own husband as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he's a savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, such as Christ of the church. So after you deal with yourself, I want you to deal with your marriages. Oh, I know, but I want to talk about spiritual warfare. No, brother. Let's go ahead and take care of this first. All right, let's talk about this first. So let's talk about your marriages. Look at the next thing on the agenda. The next thing on the checklist, he says in verse 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. Work on your relationship with your children. Praise God. Work on that relationship. Then after that, he talks about slaves and their master. Wait a minute. That's important too. Because you represent Christ at work. Amen. Don't be coming up here shouting and evangelizing and do all of that. And people that you just, you know, you at work cussing your employees out or cussing out your, you know, your coworkers. Amen. All right. Because that's important to God too, because this all has to do with your testimony. With your witness. I can't trust you with spiritual things if you don't live upright and represent me the proper way. Praise God. So employment is important. If you are a man and you are not disabled, then you should do what? That's in the Bible. Amen. That's in the Bible. You know, it's nice. I wish we could all get Social Security. I really do. Sometimes I wonder, is there a way I can find God? I mean, something. Jesus, help me. I want to stay home. You know, I want to stay home and study the Bible. I remember some people say that God took them off work so they could read the word more. I was mad at God for a minute. I said, wait a minute. You took them off work to read the word, and I want to stay home and read the word too. You know, No, if you are a grown man and you don't have a disability, you need to go to work. Amen. I know it's tough, you know, but that's the truth. We got to go tell our brothers that. Amen. You know, we can only lie to the county so long. You know, we got to feel conviction. Hey, I work at the bank. I see it. And I'm like, hey, nothing wrong with you, bro. Look, one man used to walk in with his walker, and as soon as he walked in, knew the cat, you know, nobody was looking at him, he'd pick his walker up, and that used to make me so mad. That used to make me so mad, because I know he wasn't right, you know? And here I am working hard, and he's in there lying, you know? We've got to represent Christ in everything we do. There's got to be conviction. Trust me, I've had conversations with my wife. I'm like, baby, you know what? Maybe God won't get mad if we file for separation and, you know, we can get a tax break. You know, I thought about it. We can get free daycare and all this kind of stuff. I thought about it. Trust me, because child care is expensive. Then we have that conversation, babe. Yes, we did. I'm not going to lie to you, man. And it was recently, too. Yeah, this was recently. It was real recent. I'm talking about recent. I'm serious. I'm still debating, so y'all pray for me. I say, hey, you know, I've been giving to Caesar with Caesar. Sometimes Caesar got to pay back. All right? I'm serious. So I'm telling you, you know, but we got to represent Christ. You know, and casting out imagination. Trust me, believe me, pray for me because I don't feel conviction about it. I'm telling you the truth. She feels conviction. I said, baby, we'll still be saved. But it's the truth. But then you get to finally, chapter 6, verse 10. I know I embarrassed her. I'm sorry, baby, but it's the truth. You know, finally, I was with my tax person. He told me I almost had a heart attack. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Put on the full armor of God. Now, when I was young and they started talking about the full armor of God, the first thing that came to my mind was the anointing. The anointing is my armor. You know, and the call of God on my life is the armor. You know, the oil, you know, is the armor. And man, when I started looking at it, I'm like, man, I was totally wrong. None of those things are the armor. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Now he's allowing you to understand that there are influences in heaven, in the heavenly realms, that are actually influencing our... go back really quick, brother. Verse 12. Chapter 6, verse 12. That are against the powers of this dark world and against spiritual forces. These forces are influencing the powers of this world, our governments. Like, let me give you an example. You can go up and down Old Victorville spreading the gospel message. Try to take that same gospel message to North Korea. You're going to be a martyr because you ain't going to make it. And we're going to, you know... Try to take the same gospel message to Iran. Try to take the same gospel message to China. You know, these influences are influencing these governments that are holding back the what? The Word of God. This thing is against the Word of God. Praise God. And so these governments are being utilized by the enemy to keep people from the knowledge of God. Amen. It's funny how they have all these other gods in there. No problem. But as soon as you want to take Jesus Christ, they got stuff that no, they ain't never seen even exist. They got women with 10 arms coming every which way, you know, and they're worshiping and bowing down to her because she's the god of fertility. You know, you ain't never seen something that looked like that. A beast that looked like that. And then I'm concerned about the Chinese. They know they got an overweight God that in any moment, His high blood pressure gonna get to him. I'd be concerned. I'm serious. I'd be concerned to worship him because I'm like, man, he ain't gonna make it. But you're saying a man who died on the cross, he looked like you and me. He died on the cross. Amen. For you, the only problem is him. They can worship all kind of deities, but for some reason, it is only against Jesus Christ and his word. The enemy is after the word of God. And I know that sometimes we get so caught up spiritually and emotionally that we don't put a lot of weight or value to this word. But trust me, Satan is concerned about this gospel truth going out. Now check this out. Let's keep reading. What does the next verse say? Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so when the day of evil comes, you may be able to rebuke it. Stand your ground. And after you have done everything, to stand. What's the next verse say? Stand firm then with the belt of what?
Truth.
Well, what's the truth? Because the word holds everything together. Your belt holds everything together. You know, if you lose a little weight and you don't wear your belt, sooner or later your pants, you're going to have to keep doing this number like this. Well, now young people, even if they got a belt, they still want it down here. I'm still confused why, but they still like it down here. But at any rate, you know, your belt holds everything together. And so forget the belt. What he's saying is stand firm with the truth buckled around your waist. So the first part of the armor is what? Truth. What's the next? With the breastplate of what? So now we got truth and righteousness. Well, give me the next one. With the feet fitted with the readiness that comes from what? The gospel of peace. So now we have truth, righteousness, the gospel of peace. Give me the next one. In addition to that, take up the shield, faith. So now we have truth, righteousness, the gospel, and faith. And what else did it say? With which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Verse 17. Take the helmet of salvation. Why salvation? Why would the salvation be represented by a helmet? Your mind, right? So that every decision you make it based on how it will affect your salvation. Work out your own salvation with what? With fear and trembling. If more of us wore the helmet of salvation, maybe some of the choices we made we wouldn't make. Amen? Because if we addressed our salvation with fear and trembling, we wouldn't do certain things at the dung gate. Praise God. So now we have faith. Excuse me. Now we have the truth. We have righteousness. We have the gospel. What else did we have? We had faith and we have salvation. What's the next one say? And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So far, have you heard rebuking and yelling at the devil? No, just standing. Just standing. And I'm saying that because we're going to see something, all right? And I'm talking about Satan tonight. Part two is about evil spirits, but tonight is specifically about Satan, all right? So does it say anything? It said to stand, right? Now check this out. What's the next verse say? Pray also for me that whenever I open my mouth, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. So he said, pray for me. What? That the enemy will go away? That I can effectively rebuke the enemy away? No, so that I may be able to declare the gospel message. Verse 20. For which I am an ambassador in chains, pray that I may declare fearlessly as I should. Again, he's saying, look, when the day of evil comes, I want you to take on truth. I want you to stand your ground by truth, by righteousness, by the word of God, by the gospel, by faith, by salvation. And then what's the next word say? It said, and praying always in the Spirit. We missed it, right? And praying always in the Spirit. Is that what it says, Pastor?
What verse is that?
Go back to, it was verse.
18.
Which one does it say, and praying in the Spirit?
18.
There you go. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Now, I know that when I was young, I learned that praying in the Spirit was speaking in what? In tongues. All right? And I remember watching, you know, preachers on TV when and they say, stretch your hands to the TV. And I sure would. You know, I believed, right? And they say, start praying in the Spirit for this lady's healing. Man, I'd go off in tongues. Praise God. So if praying in the Spirit means speaking in tongues, then wouldn't walking in the Spirit be walking around speaking in tongues as well? So what's the difference between praying in the Spirit and walking in the Spirit? And so let me ask you this. When you walk in the Spirit, what does that mean? But living what kind of way? Living righteousness? Living according to the will of God? Living according to the commands of God? Living according to the desires of God? So when he says pray in the Spirit, pray according to the will of God. Pray according to the commands of God. Pray according to his desires. Amen? And as we study prayer, there's a series that we do on prayer. You'll better understand that. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't speak in tongues and pray in tongues, because Paul said that he prayed in tongues more than any of them. All right. So there's room for speaking in tongues. Amen. And when we speak in tongues, we speak divine mysteries, and God will give us revelation if he so chooses. Right. Praise God. But in this occasion, he said, I need you to pray in the Spirit. I need you to pray according to the will of God. I need you to pray according to the desires of God. Amen. And so now check this out. So truth, righteousness. What is it else? What else is it? Now, I know that sometimes we want to stand up against Satan other ways. But he just outlined for us how to effectively stand against him. See, when I used to yell at him, at Satan, I'm telling you, I used to yell at him. He used to have I'd chase him down and yell at him, you know? But I realized that I didn't do anything to him until I started walking in truth. You see what I'm saying? See, because he's wanting you to yell at him, but the yelling didn't do anything to him. There's nowhere in the scripture where it says that yelling or rebuking him or hollering at him is going to cause him to do anything. Now, I want to ask you this. Satan didn't even obey God. I wonder how willing he's going to be to obey you and me. He's not going to obey you. And he has a right to be here on earth, because he was cast to the earth. I saw Satan fall like what? Lightning. Like lightning where? And he's also called the prince of what? He's called the prince of the air. This is where he needs to be. Now, I know a lot of people think that he's also in hell. And I'm going to give you some understanding. Look, I want us to keep our mind open tonight. And I want us to use some spiritual common sense. I like to call it spiritual common sense, because common sense sometimes may not make sense, you know, spiritually, because the cross is foolishness to those that are perishing. But to those, you know, but to us that are Christian, is the power of God into salvation. So if we use spiritual common sense, we think the cross, you know, is the power.